Let's look at the case where if there is a change in the input prices, how it affects the least cost input combination. So, change in input price, if you look at it, affects the optimal combination of inputs at different magnitude depending on the nature of the input price change. So, if all input price change in the same proportion, so it bound to happen, the optimal combination of inputs has to change if there is a change in the input price, either in the different magnitude or in the same magnitude, depends on the nature of the input price change. So, if all input price changes in the same proportion, the relative prices of input, that is the slope of the budget constant, or they may remain unaffected. So, if all input prices changes in the same proportion, the relative prices of inputs also, if you look at, they moves in the same proportion and those are remain unaffected. But when the input prices changes at a different rate in the same direction or the opposite direction, or the price of only one input changes while the price of other input remain constant, the relative price of input will change. Input price, when it change in the different rate in the same direction, different rate in the opposite direction, input price of one changes, other remaining constant, the relative price of input will change. This change in the relative input out price change in both in the input combination and the level of output as a result of substitution effect of change in the relative prices of input. So, this change in the relative input prices changes both the input combination and the level of output. So, whenever there is a change in the input prices, it affects the input combination and the level of output as a result of substitution effect of change in the relative price. So, a change in the relative price of inputs, either in the same or the opposite, would imply that some input have become cheaper in relation to the others. So, cost minimization firm attempts to substitute relatively cheaper inputs for more expensive one, refers to the substitution effect of relative input price change. Because whenever the price of one input changes, it becomes cheaper with respect to the other inputs. And what the cost minimizing producer or cost minimization firms, they do it over here. They generally try to replace the expensive input with respect to the cheaper inputs, and this is generally known as the substitution effect of relative input price change. So, this numericals we will just look at later, that how the quantity of labor and capital changes. Before that, we will look at the graphical representation, that when there is a change in the input prices, how it affects the least cost input, how it affects the level of output, or how it affects the level of input combination. So, initially this is the ISO cost, KL is the ISO cost, Q is the output, Q1 is the ISO quant, and this is the level of output. Now, price of labor input decreases with the help of that. Now, the quantity of the, or if you look at the ISO cost, will change from KL to KL dash. Okay. So, once it changes from KL to KL dash, then in this case, now what is the new input combination? The new input combination is, if you look at this, becomes L3, that is L1, and this is K2, this is K1. So, with the change in the input price, now, the firm will use more of labor and less of capital. That is the reason the combination, now earlier it is K1 L1, now it is K3, K2 and L3. Now, to keep it in the same level, what the producer will do, maybe at least at the same level of output, still want to change the input combination. Now, what they will do, they will try to draw a parallel line which also tangent at a point which is at this level. So, suppose this is your point E, this is your point E1, this is your point E2. So, at this case, if you look at, still it uses a higher level of leverage compared to the previous level, but it uses also a higher level of capital. So, the movement from this E to E1 is the price effect, that is in the form of L1 to L3. The movement from maybe E1 to E2 is budget effect, because the producer is trying to keep the income level, the real income level of the producer at the same level. That is the reason we got a compensated budget line, which is maybe K dash and L dash, which compensate or which maybe the reduce the real income of the producer in term of change in the input prices, and that leads to a different combination, that is E2. So, E1 to E2, E1, the movement from E2 E1 is the price effect, which is in term of the labor input use, we can say L1 and L3. Movement from E1 to E2 is, that is L2 to L3, is because of the income effect, because the real income is changing, and movement from maybe E to E2 is the substitution effect because of the change in the real income. So, if you look at the price effect is the combination of the substitution effect and the income effect. So, if you remember your price effect, substitution effect and income effect in case of the consumer theory, this is nothing but the counterpart of that in the production theory, which talks about the change in the input prices. If there is a change in the input prices, generally the producer try to substitute that with a cheaper input as compared to an expensive input. That is the reason they go on using more of that input. So, in this case also the same thing has happened. The producer is, once the price of labor has gone down, the producer has tried to optimize it and use more of the labor as compared to the capital, and that leads to the combination of the change in the input combination or also the change in the level of output. Now, next we will see the input combination, or maybe the input combination, how it changes or how to find out numerically when the production function is given, price of inputs is given like W and R, and if the production function is given and to produce a specific level of output, how to optimize the cost of production and what should be the minimum cost of production. For that, we will just take a example of a numerical example like Q is equal to 100 k, that is to the power 0.5, and L to the power 0.5. This production function is in the form of a Cobb-Douglas production function, where W is 30 and R is 40. So, W is the price of labor, that is 30 rupees, R is the price of capital, that is 40 rupees, and what we need to do here, we need to find the quantity of labor and capital that the firm should use in order to minimize the cost of producing of 144 units of output. So, if we look at this, the minimization case, like the second case where the unit of output is given, we need to minimize the cost, and what is the minimum cost we need to find out that. Then how we will go for this, we will use the, we will take the help of the Lagrangian multiplier to solve this. So, Q is equal to 100 k 0.5, and L 0.5, and here if you look at, then we have W is equal to 30 and R is equal to 40. So, first we will try to find out the composite function. Now, composite function is rupees 30 L plus rupees 40 K plus lambda dash, that is Q 0 minus 100 L to the power 0.5 K to the power 0.5. Now, the what we need to do? We need to find out the first order condition. The first order condition we need to find del Z by del L, that is 30 minus lambda dash 50 L minus 0.5 K 0.5 has to equal to 0, or 50 lambda dash L minus 0.5 K 0.5 has to be equal to 30. Suppose this is our equation 1. Now we will need to look at the first order partial derivative, or the first order derivative or the partial derivative with respect to the other input. In the first case we have checked it for L, now we will check it for K. So here we need to find out del partial derivative with respect to K, that gives us 40 minus lambda dash 50 L 0.5 K minus 0.5, which is to be equal to 0, or 50 lambda dash L 0 to the power 0.5 K to the power minus 0.5, which is equal to 40. Let us call it equation 2. Now to find out the partial derivative with respect to lambda, that is Q 0 minus 100 L 0.5 K 0.5, which is equal to 0. So you can call it 100 L to the power 0.5 K to the power 0.5, which is equal to Q 0, that is equation 3. So now if you divide equation 1 by equation 2, suppose equation 1 by equation 2, then this is 30 by 40 equal to lambda dash, that is 50 L minus 0.5 K 0.5, then lambda dash 50 L 0.5 K minus 0.5. Simplifying this again, so if you simplify this, then this is 3 by 4 equal to K 0.5 K 0.5 L 0.5 and L 0.5, that comes to 3 by 4 by K by L. So K is equal to, we can say 3 by 4 L or 0.75 L. Okay. So in order to take the first order partial derivative, once we get the partial derivative or the first order derivative with respect to L, then the first order derivative with respect to K, and then the first order derivative with respect to lambda, and then we solve for the value K in term of L. Now what we have got from all this calculation, that is K is equal to 3 by 4 L. Now we will see how we can substitute the value of K into value of this into the equation and find out the value of K and L, because ultimately what we need to find out, we need to find out ultimately to produce 144 units of output, what is the minimum cost, because the minimum cost the firm has to incur, or what should be the minimum cost, or on which ISO cost they have to rely on. So if you substitute the value of K into the given production function for 144 units of output, that is 144, that is 100 L 0.5 and 0.75 L, because K is equal to 0.75 L, so that comes to 100 L 0.75, which comes to 144 100 0.75, then it comes to 144 86.6, that comes to 16.67. so 16.67 is the value of L. Now we need to find out K is equal to 3 by 4 L, so that comes to 12.5. So 12.5 is the capital and 16.67 is the labor. So capital and labor, we got the value of capital and labor. Next, we need to find out what is the cost when the capital is labor is 16.67 and capital is 12.5. Because ultimately, again, let me remind it, ultimately we need to find out what is the minimum cost of producing this given level of output. So, C is equal to WL plus RK. So, W is 30, L is 16.67 plus R is 40 and K is 12.5. So, that comes to ₹100.1000.50. So, in order to produce 144 output, this is the minimum cost. So, this is the given level of output and this is the minimum cost. So, whether it is a minimization case or maximization case, how generally we solve it? Numerically, we solve it numerically with the help of this Lagrangian multiplier method, where we take into the constant in the form of a Lagrangian multiplier. We formulate a composite function, then we take the first order partial derivative with respect to 0. Simplifying this, that gives us the value of capital and labor. We put the value of capital and labor in the production function equation. We get the exact value of capital and labor, use this in the cost function, and that gives us the minimum cost of producing the given level of output. Now, let us see, if you remember in the last class, we talk about the short run production function, that is in term of the law of diminishing return. Next, we will see that numerically how we get the value of the three stages, the different stages of production, and how we find out the value of average product, marginal product, and at what level generally the diminishing marginal return set in, and what level labor is the average product of labor is the highest. So, the firm produces the output according to the production function, that is Q is equal to 100 KL minus LQ. So, the production function is 100 KL minus L to the power Q. Capital is fixed at 10 because this is a short run production function. Now, what we need to do, we need to find out the value of average product, we need to find out the value of marginal product, and then maybe we can find out what is the different stages or what is the different level of output or level of labor where the farm or where the producer is achieving the different level of output. So, first we will find out the marginal product of labor. Now, marginal product of labor is del Q by del L. So, that comes to 20 KL minus 3 L square. So, that comes to 200 L minus 3 L square. Now, this is the marginal product of labor. Now, we will find out the average product of labor. Average product of labor is Q by L. So, that comes to 10 K L minus L square, which is equal to, since K is equal to 10. So, this is 100 L minus L square. Okay. So, average product for average product is 100 L minus L square, marginal product for labor is 200 L minus 3 L square. Now, second one is we need to find out when MPL is maximum. MPL is maximum where the first order partial derivative with respect to L is equal to 0. So, that comes to 200 minus 6 L, which is equal to 0, L is equal to 33.33. Now, what is the significance of this level of labor? The significance of this level of labor is that at this level, since marginal product of labor is maximum, beyond this generally the law of diminishing return set in. If you remember your three stages of production function, like how the total product curve. So initially it is convex, then it is convex, and then it is decreasing. So this, corresponding to this, our marginal product of labor is maximum, because after this the total product of labor is increasing at a decreasing rate, and beyond this, this MPL is maximum, and beyond this, if you look at, then the total product is increasing at the decreasing rate and marginal product is decreasing. So we can say, corresponding to this point, MPL is maximum, and this is the point where the law of diminishing return set in. Then the second point we will look at is when MPL is equal to 0. MPL is equal to 0 when this 200L minus 3L square is equal to 0. So in this case, maybe L is equal to, if you find out, this comes to 66.66, and where this value of L comes, the value of L comes at this point, because corresponding to this, MPL is 0 and TPL is maximum. So if you remember, from till this point, this is your point, this is your point beyond which there is the law of diminishing return set in. Then when a average product of labor is highest, average product of labor is highest when DAPL with respect to DL is 0, that comes to L is equal to 50. So this comes somehow here, the average product of labor is maximum when it is intersecting the marginal product of labor. So corresponding to this, L is equal to 50. So now we can say that from 0 to 50, the first stage of production, from 50 to 66 unit of labor, second stage of production, and beyond 66 unit of labor, we have third stage of production. And how we have identified this first stage, second stage, and third stage? First stage ends till the point the marginal product is equal to the average product, and average product is maximum at that point where marginal product is equal to the average product. Where the second stage ends? Second stage ends when the total product level is maximum or the marginal product is 0. So that achieve at the unit of labor unit at 66. Beyond 66, we have the third stage of production. So depends upon the labor unit, we can find out at which level generally the stages of production are decided, whether at the first stage, whether at the second stage, and third stage. So first stage is up to a point where the marginal product of labor is equal to the average product of labor. Second stage is the point where total product of labor is maximum, marginal product of labor is 0, and third point is beyond this. So once we find out the value of labor where marginal product of labor is equal to 0, that is the definition of the second stage. Once we find out the maximum value of APL, that gives us the maybe the beginning of the second stage. And when we find the marginal product of labor is maximum, that gives us the point beyond which the law of diminishing return set in. So in the next session, we will talk about the cost of production, different types of cost, how the cost function is formulated, and what is the logic of different shape of the cost function in the short run and in the long run. So these are the session references. Generally, these are the references that is being used for the preparation of this particular session.